and youth in varying degrees. His core is helping discuss issues of the Black male form, having conversations about the effects of trauma, and helming talks about the ins and outs of the criminal justice system in America. A Texas native, Corey has formerly lived in Portland, Oregon, and currently lives in Washington State. Corey loves engaging others in tough conversations about race and diversity and having people do the work to advocate for anti-racism. Corey is ABD, earning a PhD in industrial organizational psychology. He is currently a diversity officer who works at the University of Washington.
Thank you. Thanks so much. Can everybody hear me? I'll project. You can't hear me? Is that better? Okay, I'll project as best as possible. Thank you. My name is Corey Clay. I grew up in Houston, Texas. I currently reside in Seattle, Washington. Myself, my wife, a dog, and a cat, and that's pretty much it. I am the diversity officer for the engineering department at the University of Washington. I do have a prior background, which was pretty much military law enforcement. And then after that experience, I was like, no. So about 12 years ago, I began teaching. I've taught at pretty much four different universities. And like I said, currently I'm a diversity officer for the engineering department. I want to have this discussion. I created this presentation about a year ago. There'll be some trigger warnings as well, but I want to go ahead and get started and leave some time for conversation. Okay, there we go. Okay. The first thing I want to do is give a land acknowledgement. We honor and acknowledge that we are on the traditional territories and ancestral homelands of the Cheyenne and Arapaho nations. We acknowledge the land and history of this space we are fortunate to gather in today. So why this conversation? I'm an academic and I also mentor, and I mentor a lot of young Black men. And this data came out recently about just the literacy rate or lack thereof when it came to Black men being only 14% proficient in reading by the fourth grade. Now, if this was the case of any other group of people, this would be a national security risk. And so being the diversity officer for engineering department, part of my job is like, hey, Corey, we want to gather more engineers that look like you, et cetera, et cetera. I'm like, well, it's hard if we're starting from this. You know, to get from zero to the University of Washington, and we are working with young men who are, you know, in the education system that have a literacy rate of 14%. And when you look at the numbers as well, only about 20% of these young men have a chance of graduating from high school. So that's where I'm starting from. So to go, like I said, from this to mentor these young men, and oh, by the way, you can be an engineer one day, it's not an easy task. And so I like to use the data as well, because the data sort of helps me, like, let me know where I'm going with this information. I can't just be anecdotal, like, we need more Black engineers. Like, okay, well, what does the data say and why? And so my job is to take the anecdotal from the concrete as my job as a diversity officer when it comes to trying to recruit and retain not just students, but also faculty and staff as well. And so, you know, I'll be Dr. Corey in a couple months. My background, like I said, it'll be a PhD in organizational psychology. I want to go through this as a psychological process and look at this as a process that we all go through. You know, when I look and talk about the Black male form, I'm talking about demonizing one and demonizing a body and making it seem less than human. I'm a veteran. Like I said, I worked in law enforcement. I've also traveled. I've been to every continent in this planet, and I can say that my experiences are far different than others. For the most part, I've had a good time. I'm cute. I can get by. I'm also somewhat husky, so people don't mess with me. You know, I have a angry visage, I guess. But for the most part, I've been able to get through this life unscathed. But that's also something that we're going to talk about later, just having to be on one end demonized and on the other end having to be damn near perfect for the most of my life. If you meet any Black man that has been, you know, get a PhD or a master's degree, they've probably had to navigate this Western culture with lots of landmines. So to be from where I'm from, to be here, my sister also has a PhD. My mom was just PhDs, you know, but we've had to navigate certain things. And as far as like having to navigate the military, having to navigate academia, it's not been difficult, but I try to use what I experience and my lived experience to help others. The thing is with this concept is like, this form can never truly integrate. The Irish could, Italians could, but for Black men especially, and I try not to negate Black women, but I'm, you know, specifically focused on the agency of Black men, because I think that Black women have the agency to speak for themselves, and I'm an ally if they need me to be, but also be able to have this conversation and realize that Black men have been demonized on a spectrum where you have racism, then you have anti-Black racism, and it is on a spectrum. And we can see that in reality right now. You look at what happened to that young man, Ralph Jarl. You know, he went to go get his friends, and, you know, an 84-year-old man shot him. He didn't die. It also happened, you know, a couple years ago in in Michigan, where a young man had the wrong house and he was shot at. So this form is demonized to a point to where, you know, it's hard to navigate. So we have to have this conversation. So like I said, this is a process. And step one is that this is innate. For most of us, we want to harm, not most of us, in general, we have in-groups and we have out-groups. But it goes against our wiring to, you know, to kill members of the human species. So it's also counterintuitive. So you see me as a human being, but yet if you think about historically Black men in Western culture, we've been demonized. So it's innate. And it's also, you know, let's take race out of it for a second. You look at different, you know, different groups. Look what's happening in Russia right now in Ukraine. You know, these are people are technically cousins, and yet one group is the out group. Look at different tribes in Africa. Look at Rwanda. You have different tribes, and, you know, well, we have to make this group an out group. And so it is innate, but it's also counterintuitive. Like, why do we have to do that with each other? And we've been doing this. A lot of this programming starts young. I think about, like, I'm from Texas. I played Texas high school football, and, you know, we would fight the other team, and it was just like, oh, we got to go fight. And it was interesting because our mascots were like the Apaches, which is a whole other, you know, the Rangers versus the Apaches. Like, this is historically really messed up. But that was the out group at the time. So what we have to do is we have to create a psychological loophole. If you think that murder, rape, and torture are universally bad, then dehumanization of the other is a psychological loophole that you have to sort of create. You know it's bad to harm someone that looks like me. So what do we have to do to make this feel normal? We create these psychological loopholes when we look at someone like what happened to the young man on the subway. We're going to talk about that later. He was choked out on Monday to death. And he was choked to death by a 24-year-old Marine, someone who had a mental health issue, a Black man on a subway. And I've worked with the unhoused population. He needed help. He did not deserve to be choked to death for 15 minutes. And then I watched a clip this morning on Fox News and Hannity, who had a town hall talking about it. And he was discussing it because he was trying to like demonize AOC, whatever, whatever. And there was a woman in the audience that when he was talking about it, she clapped. Yay. They killed that guy. Yay. And he kept on going because, of course, he's not going to stop because that's what he's trying to generate. But to have that form to be killed in that manner, and for it to be normalized is a loophole that many people have to deal with. We create these loopholes, and it is a psychological process. I should give a trigger warning before this, and I apologize, but like trigger warning, but I have to show this part as well, because this goes into the loophole. This talks about lynchings in America. Most lynchings were of African-American men in the South, but also women. More than 73% of lynchings in the post-Civil War period occurred in Southern states, Mississippi, Texas, and Georgia. The reason I'm showing this picture is because this picture is very specific. My grandfather was born in 1938. This was in the 1950s. I was born in the 1970s. So we like to talk about this as if it was ancient history, but it wasn't. The reason I show this picture too is because after they lynched the person, what they did, and you see like at the far, your far left, you know, there's a couple holding hands and smiling. After they lynched this black man, they had a picnic under his body. Once again, like I said, I'm in my 40s. I was born in 1977. This isn't that far removed to where, oh, that's ancient history. No. And like I said, my grandfather was born in 1938. He passed away in October. He would tell me these stories about just how they would grab his cousin and how they would abuse his mother. How they would abuse his father. He was a Korean veteran. My great-grandfather was a World War II veteran. When he got back from World War II, dehumanization. They would not let him work. He was killed by white men after serving this country. And so I show this because this, like I said, I want to, you know, just put in the concept that this didn't happen like years ago. This is less than 100 years ago. Not only lynch and burn the bodies, but then have a picnic under it. And that was normalized. And then step three is animalistic dehumanization. When you just deny human attributes to primarily black men. And it goes back to eugenics and a lot of junk science where they tried to use phrenology and compare, you know, black men to orangutans. But they still do it. That picture of Destroy This Mad Brute, that was a World War I picture that they were using, you know, talking about the Germans coming and using the white woman as freedom. But then, you know, some 80 years later, they did this, well, not that long ago, with LeBron James and Gisele Bündchen, and that was taken by, I forget her name, she's a very famous photographer, but thank you, Annie Leibovitz, where she decided to use this image to have this, you know, projection of LeBron James as an animal, as a gorilla, and with this helpless white woman. So this, once again, this isn't like, oh, this is happening in the past. This is pretty recent, I think less than 10 years ago. Also, I watched the NFL draft, and I'm not a sports person, but I watched it just because I was trying to prove a point, and it was proven quite quickly. Just some of the language that was used recently when they were drafting many of these black men, especially the defensive players. Damn, we got a hoss. He's a beast. You know, just using animalistic terms to describe these black men who are going to be professional football players. That was last weekend. Of course, when they were describing the quarterbacks, they were talking about the intelligence of the black man. But when they're talking about especially the defensive positions, he's a stud. That's how they used to describe horses. So like I said, this is happening in real time. This isn't like something that's just happened in the past. Step four is describing black men as having subpar intelligence, this brute caricature. You know, portrays black men as innately savage, animalistic, destructive, and criminal, deserving of punishment, maybe death. This was in a lot of the literature in the 1950s and 60s, a lot of pulp literature. You know, and of course, you have the image there and the language, How Sleeps the Beast, where you have this white woman and this black male farm person, and of course, he can't resist her, and they use this language to basically scare white people into thinking of black men as these savage caricatures. Also, in more than enough times, many times in my life, I've been referred to as articulate. Thank you. But, you know, brother got three master's degrees. I have a PhD in a couple months. I don't need to be told. I hope I'm articulate. But just when it goes to the subpar intelligence piece of many black men, I think it's very damaging. Also, this, I haven't highlighted this bull concept. I'm about to tell some inside business. I was at another conference recently, and a woman came up to me at a bar, and I was like, just kind of sitting there. And she was like, you know, you want to hang out? I'm like, I'm good, happily married. like, and just basically I could use a bull like you. And I was like, flirting is one thing. Dehumanizing me is another. I'm still from the hood, so just back up. And then she tried to explain it to me, just basically like, you know, that's part of my play. That's sex play. It's race play. I'm like, yeah, that's, do your thing. Like I said, I was in Vancouver, BC, whole other topic. But I'm just like, number one, I'm not going to hook up with you. Number two, to also basically know that I'm married and still be like, I'm a white woman. How can you say no to me? I'm married to a white woman. I'm good. Like, you know, but to use that to bull or stud to refer to me, but, you know, sexuality and virile, et cetera, et cetera. It was just kind of shocking. I'm like, kind of taken aback. Like, thank you, but, you know, we're good. But it was to her, it was like I was doing her a disservice. I'm like, you're the one that came up to me. And then step five is just this normalizing of black male hatred. So these are some quotes that came out recently. So the first one I'll read is about Tyre Nichols. Tyre Nichols was killed by five black officers recently in Memphis, Tennessee. And the quote that was used was, "This all could have been avoided with one simple move. Tyre Nichols could have complied from the moment he was pulled over out of that car. If you watch this interaction, he never complies until the end." Did anyone actually watch that interaction? Having worked in law enforcement, when you have five versus one, and at the time that he was complying, he had no choice. And at a certain point when he did run, it's because you think that, hey, I might lose my life. I'm going to run. And he did lose his life. The next quote is about George Floyd. This was an officer testifying in favor of Derek Chauvin. "I felt that Officer Chauvin's interactions with Mr. Floyd were following his training, following current practices in policing, and were objectively reasonable. Having worked in law enforcement and the military, there was never any training that I had where I would put my knee on somebody's neck." Even the police code, there was no training like that. So for someone to say that, this was part of the training to put your knee, your entire weight. I'm a 250-pound man. At no point would I ever do that to subdue somebody. The next quote, "I am urging parents of black and Latino youngsters, particularly not to let their children go without wearing hoodies. I think the hoodie is as much responsible for Trayvon Martin's death as much as George Zimmerman." That was Geraldo Rivera. So basically saying that the hoodie is what caused Trayvon Martin's death. Not the fact that he got shot walking home with Skittles and an iced tea, the hoodie. And then the final one was developing a search warrant, marijuana found in Botham Jean's apartment after the deadly shooting. 2018, a cop in Dallas, Amber Geiger, went into the wrong apartment and then shot and killed the wrong person. And they found a small amount of marijuana in his house. And, well, I guess he deserved it. I don't know how that marijuana equated to his death, but these are the quotes that come out usually when black men are killed. They deserve this. And so it becomes normalized, like whatever happens, happens. He must have deserved this because of having a small amount of marijuana or whatever the case may be. And so what happens with step six is that we in this body become the other. Numerous studies have examined the portrayal of black men in the media. According to one study, in music videos and movies, black males are more frequently depicted with guns and in violent settings than our white male counterparts. The criminal is unproductive, antisocial, unbound for morals, and thus dangerous, dirty, and unfit for humanity. So we then become the universal other. Having been to different countries, Australia, et cetera, I see that. And for the most part, like I stated, I get along just fine. But I've been othered in Australia. My wife and I are going to London. I'm like, I didn't want to go back, but we're going to London in July. I had a bad experience last time I was there. Every place that I go, I know that I'm probably going to be watched, or I understand this. I live in Seattle. It's different. It's like everybody wants to be my friend. I'm fine. Leave me alone. It's just That's just me. I'm just like, wherever I go, just leave me alone. I just usually me and my dog. It's me and a Scottish Terrier. But I understand where I go, I'm going to be watched or observed, whether it's a coffee shop, whether when I travel to Spain, whatever the case may be. Sometimes it's nothing. It's innocuous, but at least I'm cognizant of that. And once again, I don't want to speak for every Black male, but I think every Black male knows that and has that feeling when we go certain places, we're being watched sometimes. We're quite cognizant of our space. I have an office, and when certain people come into my office, I leave the door open. Why? If a white woman comes into my office and she wants to talk about something, especially my position, I usually leave the door open. I'm not going to do anything, but there's that perception. Also, I know my history. If she says something about me, I could lose my job. That's something that many of us are cognizant of. And so we become the universal other, and so we have to move differently in this world. And then step seven is, you know, this is psychology, storming, forming, and norming. It's just forming of an accepted concept now that the Black male form is bad. Hatred of the Black male form becomes normalized in society, and it becomes structural. You look at the laws. I have a master's degree in criminal justice. I worked in criminal justice. Crack versus cocaine. If you get caught with cocaine, drug aversion program, you look like me, get caught with crack, you are going to jail. I have a cousin, marijuana, Texas, 3 strikes, almost 20 years in state prison for marijuana, something that I can purchase right down the street. I know because I looked it up as soon as I got here. I mean, I live in Washington, Colorado, it's the same laws. But yeah, he spent 20 years in a state penitentiary for something most of us can go purchase legally in this state. And so, but that's just the way it is. And so, you know, the previous presenter talked about like doing the work. I'm trying to work with state legislation in Washington. I'm trying to help people because like there are still people incarcerated in Washington state that for possession of marijuana. Why? If it's been decriminalized and this state as well in Oregon. And then it becomes external as well as internal. Meaning that when you look at statistically, if I was to be the victim of a violent crime, it's more than likely going to be by someone that looks like me. Same thing if you're white. This whole misnomer of Black on Black crime. Crime is highly intraracial. That means if you are the victim of a violent crime, it's going to be by someone that looks like you. There is a small percentage that I am going to get you. But it becomes normalized. And this is the piece, I don't think where I get in trouble, but sometimes when I do talk to young men, especially young Black men, I talk about culture. And just talk about the culture like, hey, you know, you have to do X, Y, Z. And it goes back to this whole like thing where you have to be perfect. And I feel bad that I have to mentor young Black men that way, but I have to. Like, yo, you have to be damn near perfect to survive. If I would have ever done anything wrong in this 46 years of life, I probably would not be here. And that becomes stressful. So it is external and internal as well. But sometimes I do talk about the culture. When I do mentor young Black men, and there was a one man the other week, and I was mentoring him, and it was N-word that, Mr. Corey, N-word this. And I'm like, look, you're about to go off to college. If that's how you want to present, cool. But understand that you're going to have to change some of that language you're using when you get to college. He understood that, and I wasn't trying to demonize him. I'm just letting him know the rules are going to change for you pretty soon. He understood what I was saying. His mother understood what I was saying. And so you try to work with what you have. Like, look, I'm just trying to let you know what's going to happen. Let me set you up for positivity and not set you up for failure. And so step eight is that it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. Dr. Claude Anderson warned back in 1995 about the especially Black men becoming a permanent underclass, in particular, Black men. We as Black men are only, well, as Black people, only 12% of the population. Cut that in half, we're only 6%. There aren't that many of us here, to be honest. But in about 15 years, this will become a majority-minority country when you'll have more Black, Latinx, Asian people. And so I want to see what's going to happen in about, because they say 20 years. I think it's going to happen in 15. I think they really don't survey the Asian population as they should. So when the data comes back, I think in the next 15 years, there will be more brown people than white people. But when you look specifically at black men, there is this fissure there where we have kind of given up on them as society. Black boys are most at risk at remaining in or stuck in poverty. According to the Bureau of Justice data, black men face a higher chance of being incarcerated. And so given the weight of evidence for black men, African-American men specifically, and their unique plight, we have to break the cycle of intergenerational disadvantage. And so we need to start thinking about like a new deal. What can we actually do if we care about this group? I think when I saw that literacy data, that's when I became like really, really involved. I think whoever I would have been, if I was white or Asian or whatever the case, when I saw that, I'm like, okay, this is a problem. So what are we going to actually do to fix it? Because I hate just coming into places and like talking and then walking away. Like there are some solutions that we have to find to fix this when it comes to the black male form. The discouragement of dehumanization has three powerful henchmen. One is fear. 2020 statistics, most violent incidents against whites is 69% and blacks, 66% of victims were committed by an offender in the same race. Crime is highly intraracial. This is crime in general. I used the violent crime statistics earlier. This is just crime in general. There's also conditioning. People are conditioned to believe that black male bodies are biologically inferior, more prone to crime, and lazier. One might live in a trailer in Richmond, Texas, but at least somehow they can say that I am better. And I'm talking about a white person. I'm better than this person. Being from the South, I used to see a lot of different interactions between whites and Latin people and black people. And, you know, hey, Corey, at least I'm not black. And it's funny when I go back home, when I lived in Texas and, you know, people would see me because I'm very petty. So like, how'd you get that Porsche, Corey? I'm like, man, forget you. No, I'm just, I am the king of petty, but I'll help you out. But I think that conditioning becomes apparent when we have situations like what happened in that subway. For someone to be choked out for 15 minutes and then for someone to celebrate that, I think that is a form of conditioning. And then, of course, confirmation bias. 99% of black people will not commit a crime. Yet even this morning, being here in Colorado, I watched the news, the local news here, like just to basically prep for this. And there was a robbery and they showed the black suspect. And I'm like, is that all they can find in Denver? Because then I looked up I Googled the crime statistics and it's not a lot of black people here. But that's what they put on the news this morning, the black robbery suspect. I'm like, okay. So, I mean, and even when I lived in Portland, Oregon, which has a small black population, I would watch the local media and we have to find the black person that did this. Like, you're really trying hard because Portland is the meth capital of the world. And this is what you're going to promote? And so to actually help people out, we have to try a couple things. Mentorship programs, such as Mentoring Alliance, led by Dr. Sean Joe for Black Boys. They have actually strengthened communities. There's data on that where mentorship matters. It doesn't take a lot of time. I mentor about an hour a week between just mentor and then the reading program, trying to teach young black boys to read. I use comic books. And you'd be surprised how much, and because I collect them as well. But I use these as tools, honestly, when it comes to my literacy program or working with you, because they're like, okay, cool. But they're learning to read and it's something I have tons of them. So I'll bring those to me. And it's amazing how much it works. Like there's one little boy came to me like, hey, Mr. Corey, what's a visage? Because it was like Wolverine had an angry visage like an animal. I'm like, cool, we got this. It means facial expression. So you'd be surprised when you have a six-year-old or eight-year-old who's having difficulty reading and you use something like a comic book to try to get through to them, it actually works. So mentoring works. Criminal justice reform to truly address any social issues, right, when it comes to black boys, write your senator or congressman. Caveat, even there was Senator Warnock. He worked with our team at UW recently, trying to basically come up with a STEM program to help young black men. And that just kind of fell into my lap. And so this is someone who's on a different spectrum from, like, he's very religious, MLK church, but he understands that there needs to be more STEM programs out there for young black men. But it is also hard when you're looking where he's coming from, Atlanta. That's why I reached out to Seattle, to UW. But yes, I've written my congressman and senator several times. They actually respond. We need something when it comes to criminal justice reform, especially what I focus on is marijuana recidivism. You should not be in jail for something right now that's legal in the state. What are we going to do about it? Sometimes I get a response, sometimes I don't. And then, of course, improving the education system. That's a heavy lift because you have people right now who are trying to defund the education system, which I find to be just highly counterintuitive. And so we have to figure out a way to try to work on that as a group. I'm talking about just in general as human beings. Because right now what I'm seeing in the education system with young black men is really startling, like especially when it comes to that point about literacy. So in my position, even though I work in higher ed, I spend a lot of time traveling to the elementary schools. And it's staggering what the little black boys tell me too, like, I want to be a mechanic. I'm like, no, you can be an engineer. I want to be a nurse. No, you can be a doctor. So it's trying to get them from point A to point Z, but also you got to provide templates. And so we have to really find ways to improve our education system. But those are three things that we can do: the mentorship, the criminal justice reform, and the education system. And now what I've been waiting for, now I have 16 minutes for questions. It's that after lunch malaise.
Thank you for your presentation. Mm-hmm. What are some things that we can do to be proactive? In my youth, I grew up in foster care and I had black brothers and sisters, and I get it wholeheartedly. But when I saw like the Malcolm X movie when I was a kid, and there was a blonde woman who walked up and said, "Hey, what can I do? I believe in what you're fighting for." And he said, "Go home. There's nothing you can do." And sometimes we don't want to be the person to help. Do you know what I mean?
I work with a faculty. I work with a faculty of engineers that are afraid to talk to me. So I get it. I also believe in allyship. My biggest thing is having allies and to move from being an ally to an accomplice. So I know that part you make, that part you're talking about in that movie, I don't agree with that. I also think that was a film, but I understand. I understand at the time. What Malcolm X was doing was totally different than where we're at now.
Oh, I get that.
But I think that we need everybody, especially humanists, need to be allies and accomplices. Mm-hmm. And I don't mean this in a negative way. I know I have plenty of friends in Portland who have a Black Lives Matter sign in front of their door, and I know I'm the only black person they know, which is fine, but I think we need to move beyond the sort of performative allyship. What are we going to do? Are we going to go and mentor? Are we going to actually use our power to do something when it comes to writing our congressman? I'm a big fan. I'm a huge fan of ally. Like I said, and my wife is white, super white. So she's just very pale. But I mean, I believe in just basically having allies in different places because we can't do this alone. Like I just mentioned the numbers. Like we're 12% of the population. And I think that at this point, we are becoming a second-class citizenship in our own country. So is it going to get worse or get better? I don't know.
Right. Yeah. I was one of the only white people at Trayvon Martin's memorial there. My daughter and I went wearing our hoodies. So anyway, I just appreciate you talking.
No, thank you. Go
ahead. Hi. Oh, it is on. I mentioned in a previous session I'd been in the Peace Corps, and when I returned from overseas, that's right at the time that Watts blew up in California. And I'd been raised in Idaho and Montana, and I knew zero about what the heck was going on. So I got a job at Peace Corps headquarters in Washington, D.C., and there was a notice on the bulletin board saying, how would you like to volunteer out in Southeast D.C.? A bunch of kids out there. So I thought, okay, I can learn something. And I went out. It wasn't enough, though, once a week to go for an hour at a time. I got to know the taxi driver better than I did the little girl I was tutoring. So right next to the library were three big tenement buildings, and they were renting. So I said, hey, I'll move out there. And I went back to Peace Corps to change my address because I was working there. And these are people who worked all over the world in different cultures. But yet there was a certain taboo about me living in Southeast D.C. and helping out there. But it was one of the best experiences I've had. The people in the community there took me in, knew I was tutoring, and kind of watched me for a while. And I started taking some of the kids to sightsee. D.C. is a wonderful place. And to this day, I have really good friends there. And initially, the women were a little skeptical. It was the miniskirt time, right? So...
because I want to make sure that sure. other people have time.
Yeah.
If I have a question, please ask. And then if you have other comments, I'm sure he's more than happy to have a discussion. Thank you.
I was just going to make a comment that it's really good to mix it up. Don't let somebody say, don't help, don't get involved. Do get involved. We're all people in one country.
Thank you. Yes.
I've just been reading Richard Reeves' book of Men and Boys, and his entire thesis is that we've been giving a lot of emphasis to feminist issues, but he's pointing out that men and boys, particularly Black men and boys, are at a particular disadvantage. And some of his suggestions for changing this is to get more Black people involved in education, recruiting Black teachers, because they will be then both teachers and mentors. Where do we start in this process if we're not Black to improve the educational system for Black men and boys?
I'll say this, and I'm glad that you said that, and I'll make a more macro conversation. For any of my white people out there, you can't be afraid to like go in this, like, I'm glad you mentioned that, because to improve the education system is going to take everybody's effort. It is going to take time. And I'm not saying this to demonize the education system. Also, as far as teachers, I wouldn't want to be a K-12 teacher right now. You cannot pay me enough. That's why I work in higher ed. So it's a difficult profession, number one. And then to couple that with, you know, being a person of color in that profession as well. Like, I work in higher ed, so I can kind of do what I want, but one of my best friends is an elementary school teacher, and there's this concept also of invisible labor. So you are a Black teacher and you have to do X, Y, Z, and you have nothing. So it's a difficult concept. I donate to my elementary school. I take first of the year, I'll go spend $200 on crayons and stuff like that because I think it's needed. But it's an interesting question because it's a difficult profession. And I think they're trying to do a lot with the little, and that's in whole. And then couple that with being a person of color, or especially a Black man having to deal with other landmines as well. It's hard. So donate, ask specifically what schools need. Like, I went to the elementary school in my neighborhood. Like, what do y'all need? We need crayons. We need pencils. We need X, Y, Z, because teachers aren't getting paid enough and have to use their money, their own personal money, to buy that stuff. And I think the financial burden shouldn't be put on them at a public school.
Hi. We have some questions from virtual attendees. One of them is, can you speak more about specific mentoring activity and how to connect with children, young adults, or adults who are seeking mentors?
Gotcha. I think and I'll send this email, that program I mentioned, but the main program, and I think every state has it, is called a SMART program, and it's basically teaching the, it's basically a literacy program. If there's any literacy program at an elementary school or state, please join that literacy program, because when we look at those numbers, that matters. And I think that's going to be ultimately harmful. If that literacy rate stays the same, that's not a good thing. So any mentorship program, and I think it's all state by state. I don't think there are too many federal ones, but any state or local mentorship program is needed.
Okay. Great. Thank you. The next question is, can you speak more about specific The next question is from Carolyn Brown. Do you think increasing suffrage among Black men will change anything?
I don't know. And I don't know. And I mean, because that's, I'm a Black male over 35, and I'm not trying to brag. I make well over six figures. That means that my life outcomes are the same as a white male comparable. But how did I get here? And so if I can provide any help to any other young Black man to get here, whatever here is, that's what's needed. But it's trying to teach young men to navigate those landmines. And it's hard because, once again, like, if I'm on your life for like an hour or a week or a month as a mentor, and I'm all you got, but also I still mentor young men that I mentored 10 years ago. So those relationships also matter. If they need a letter of recommendation, or, hey, Corey, can you look at my resume? That matters, because sometimes, even at the University of Washington, I have students that come to me that I never taught before, but you're the diversity officer and this ex-professor won't do this. Can you write this recommendation for me to get this internship? I'll do it, but I'm in a unique place. It also goes into academia because, you know, I work with Boeing, I work with Raytheon, I work with Amazon as well to try to, because you have to have that. It's not like they say, it's not what you know is who you know. And if you know people, like, hey, come look at so-and-so because there's a job at Boeing. Now, I have issues with Boeing, but, you know, I work with engineers as well. So if they want to get a job, and that's the thing, it's to basically take down barriers. I know Corey. Corey knows this student. Let me take a look at this student. A lot of young Black men don't get that.
Thank you.
Yes.
I work with a local secular community here, and I do a lot of youth programming. And we as a community wanted to make sure that we're reaching out to everyone within the secular community, and notice that, you know, we are not always touching every population, especially those of color, BIPOC, secular members of the population. And we had a table last year at the Juneteenth Festival, because we just wanted to make sure people knew we were here. And that's a festival largely attended by our BIPOC population here in the area. How can we be present and be a resource for our communities of color in the local area without overstepping the appropriate role for us to take in making sure that we are providing resources and being a resource for young men and women of color to be a part of secular communities like ours? Are there other things you can suggest?
Yeah. Number one, always show up. Number two, and this is why I'm up here, I'm a Black agnostic atheist. And I'm like, this is some real talk. There are spaces where I'm not wanted by Black people. And I think every Black person in here, you know, I am a unicorn. I was invited to speak at a group recently, and then they found out that, oh, you're a humanist. Do you believe in God? I'm like, no, disinvited. It's hard because of, this will be a next year conversation. Black people and religion. I mean, it's tied together. That's a loaded conversation, but always show up. I am in spaces now where I let people know, like, hey, if you want my help, cool, but I'm a humanist. I'm an agnostic atheist. If you want my help, cool. I work with a group called Space Between. We've come up with a diversity program to help youth. It's all, once again, it's also geographical. It's Seattle. It's a very secular city. But I've been disinvited from a lot of things because of that tie between Black people and Christianity or whatever the case may be. And it stings, but, you know, I'm still here. If you want to work with me, cool. But if not, but always show up and at least provide examples, because I didn't know what a humanist, agnostic, or atheist was. I just knew at 12 years old, this didn't make a lot of sense. Also a preacher's kid, so the ultimate heathen. It's to be here. No, I'm just, My mom is texting me now. Are you done with those bad people, baby? I'm like, no.
Thank you.
She understands. She gets first class tickets to Seattle. So it's all good. One more. Go
ahead. I'm not exactly sure how to word all this, but I'm going to try real quickly so we can get straight to your answer. This is a primarily white, secular, progressive, liberal group. We all have our Black Lives Matter signs in our windows. We all have our spaces here. Can you speak to the sophisticated racism that we see within progressive and liberal spaces that other Black individuals, to the point where a good friend of mine was at a service, they gave a message, they gave a talk on their philosophy, and they were told that they were eloquent. They spoke with much prestige in their language, but then were not invited back in conversation.
I'll be brief. That's why I'm not a big fan of Sam Harris. The Sam Harris, Charles Murray, whole different conversation. But the first time I joined a humanist agnostic group was in Portland, Oregon. It was through Meetup, and I showed up twice, and I was asked the second time, like, hey, this isn't really a group for you. So I'm like, and this is Portland. Like I said, this is, you know, these are the good folks. So I take that with stride. And it's funny because that same group reached out to me about 2 years ago, like during COVID. And like I mentioned before, I'm quite petty. And so that response was very, I won't say the word, but yeah, it's a difficult place to navigate. Cause I think any, like I said, to be in this position, and I got to go in a minute, but you're navigating racism and you're navigating cultural and you're navigating all these different isms. And you're just trying to basically be part of the group that you feel like, I feel like I belong more here than other groups because, you know, a humanist. But yeah, I've seen racism in humanism. Like I said, I was asked to leave because it wasn't a space for me. When I was in Canada, you know, working on my PhD, you know, there were conversations on Facebook about why can't those people just get it together? So, I mean, it still pops up. I mean, and that's the thing. So I think that every person of, I don't speak for myself. I can navigate it quite well, but I don't let it stop me. You know, I'm a veteran too. I'm also a Texan. So I'm kind of just that, I'm still kind of country, but I hide it. I don't talk like this too much, but you know, if I do start talking like this, you might want to leave. No, I'm just kidding. I try to hide it well, but no, I mean, there's a lot of that intellectual dishonesty in humanism, you know, and it can be a very unwelcome space. But for me personally, I feel more welcome in a space like this than some of the other groups out there. Thank you.